to talking about the Red Scrolls of Magic by Cassandra Clare. In case you didn't know, because Cassandra Clare has about 50,000 books out, The Red Scrolls of Magic is a Magnus and Alex story that takes place during City of Fallen Angels. So we're going way back to the books that I read almost 10 years ago and don't remember very much about. But kind of for context, this is like the very beginning part of when Malik becomes a thing. But this is going to be a trilogy, and it appears that there's going to be time jumps. So we don't really know when these are, but I'm assuming they're all gonna take place during the Mortal Instruments. I feel like they're more like concluded with their story and they're more of a settled family by the time we get to Dark Artifices, so it has to happen in that middle time. But these two are going on a European vacation and things are so funny and exciting. And it's very much one of those side novels to a Cassandra Clare series, because usually with these side books, like, I know that Alec and Magnus are alive after this. Like, there's no life-threatening thing that could happen that's going to get me too upset or too nervous, because I know what their future looks like. That doesn't mean they're not good, I just think they're not quite as freaked out as you get reading her regular series where you have no idea what's going to happen. That being said, if you have not read it, you need to leave, because I'm gonna spoil it, and you don't wanna be spoiled. You really do wanna go into this kind of fresh. Go read it, come back and discuss. Bye! Immediately we start off with like just the cutesy like couple banter between the two of them, and Alec recognizes like some of the things around Paris and he's never been there, and Magnus is like, how did you know like what that was? Alec says he studied the maps of the city before he came, and he just is like, to prepare. And this is like right after the hot air balloon fiasco of their date. Magnus had set up like all this food and stuff, and like the balloon is going, I'm picturing it just going awry, just like the two of them like hanging on for dear life, and they had like fallen off and Alec had to like save him and stuff like that. That just seemed so un-Magnus to me for a minute. Everything Magnus does is like so polished and pristine. I just couldn't picture him making a mistake, which was like, it was kind of funny to see, because like Magnus is trying to impress Alec if he's going out of his way to do things that he's like not sure are gonna work. And I thought that was kind of like a fun moment. Of course, Alec has to kill some demons on their date, but we get to see Alec in action, which was really fun. We don't get to see that very much. And then when the balloon crashes, it leaves like a bunch of damage behind. I was like, oh my gosh, what an omen for the rest of the book. I love when they're looking at the stars and Alec just makes the weirdest jokes, but they're great. Like, he's like, why is it romantic to look at the stars? And then he's pointing out different constellations that like are nothing. And he's like, look, that one, it's Dave, the hunter. So Alec and Magnus are having a more romantic moment when Tessa walks in. I was like, yes, because Tessa would be the perfect option to walk in because of Clockwork Angel. When Magnus walks in on her and they decide to call it even, I thought that was really funny. But Tessa's there to inform Magnus that people think that he is the Great Poison, the leader of a cult called the Crimson Hand, and she pretty much tells him to handle it before any institutes get involved, because that would introduce a whole slew of problems. Which leads Magnus to try to piece together his memories, because he doesn't remember doing this. The whole thing is gone. He's like, oh my gosh, what if I did that? And so when Alec walks into their apartment, Magnus has all of his scrapbooks laying around and like all these pictures, and he's trying to piece things together, and Alec is like, are you scrapbooking? To the lay observer, what I'm doing might look similar, yes. Alec asks Isabel to research the Crimson Hand, but he can't really tell her too much about it because he doesn't want anyone else involved. And then he tries to get relationship advice from Jace, and Jace does a terrible job. Alec is like, he's not explicitly saying what he needs to know, so Jace is like going off on this like rant about demon hunting, and then Isabel takes the phone, and then Jace takes the phone back, and you can hear Jace like, wait, I know what he meant! Magnus needs to go to the Paris Shadow Market, which I think is really interesting. Like, we've started to get to know what Shadow Markets are like, especially more in these like Dark Artifices series, and it's really sad because Magnus gets shunned by people who would normally talk to him. Like, nobody's coming up to him, speaking to him, and it's because of Alec. And I've never really thought about it the other way around, because we see so much from the Shadowhunter perspective that if you're like dating or with a downworlder, then like you are suddenly less than a normal Nephilim. And I've never really thought about it the other way around, like how downworlders view their own, who associate with Shadowhunters and how that could affect them socially and their businesses even, like things like that, like how precarious that relationship can be. So Alec kind of decides to keep his distance, even though he's watching Magnus like the whole time to make sure everything's fine. Magnus runs into Johnny Rook, who we've seen in other places before, and he tells Magnus that the Crimson Hand worships Asmodeus, who is a prince of hell and who is Magnus's father. We don't know very much about Magnus's history or his family. Like, for the most part, we just know that Magnus doesn't like to talk about it very much. They're trying to trade for information, and Magnus is giving Johnny a potion. It comes in the form of an ointment, and Johnny's like this, and Magnus is just like, it's an ointment, that's how it comes. So in return, Rook tells him to find a cult member named Mori Shu. And that's really all we get out of that exchange. We've never heard that name before, so like, we're gonna get some new characters. Alec finds someone mysteriously watching Magnus as he's making his way through the Shadow Market. And Alec kind of has this moment of like consciousness where he remembers, like, Magnus has a lot of past relationships. Who is this person following him? There's just like a lot of things going through his mind. And like, at the same time, Magnus is kind of plagued by this story that Malcolm told him a really long time ago about never wanting to love again after he fell in love with a Shadowhunter who was Annabelle. And like, that's kind of weighing on Magnus because he's obviously having a much longer lifespan than Alec. Later, Magnus gets a little offended that he didn't get invited to the Downworlder party. And they hear about it like on the train to Venice. And it's kind of obvious he didn't get invited because he's with Alec. This isolation of being with a Shadowhunter, like how many problems is this gonna cause for them? Like how many rifts in their relationship? Are they gonna be able to get through it? Like there's all these questions circling them on this vacation that's supposed to be really fun. But like with all that, like the whole time throughout this whole book, Magnus sees Alec treating Downworlders as equals, like with compassion. And like, that's obviously like a very important part of their relationship. Alec and Magnus are interrupted yet again by a demon this time. So Alec is fighting the demons on the train. And then the woman who had been following Magnus, he recognizes her, like the one he kind of like bought off, is fighting with him on the train. Alec saves Magnus again. I'm just still confused. Like, I know Magnus isn't like a trained shadow hunter, but he can definitely hold his own. I'm wondering why Magnus isn't fighting here. The woman's name is Xin Yun. I hope I'm saying that right, but I'm not really sure. I'm suspicious of her. She says that the Crimson Hand are the reason that her family is dead and that she just escaped from them. So I wasn't sure, was this like a recent thing? But it's apparently not. So I don't know why she's with the Crimson Hand. And even this whole time, like, Magnus is still so concerned with making sure Alec has a good time, which is so sweet because Magnus, he's traveled the world. He's seen all this and like he wants to share it now. And I thought that was so sweet. I'm like, y'all are obviously about to get into some mess here, but like that's still so sweet that he like wanted him to enjoy everything. But now also Xin Yun has joined them as like this awkward third wheel that's necessary to the plot. We move into part two and the Downworlders are having pretty much like a yay Valentine's Dead party, and they've called it any day but Valentine's Day. And Magnus meets up with Malcolm Fade, who has thrown this party. And like, it's just kind of weird to see him knowing all the crazy things that happen later. And then Magnus meets up with Katarina, who I love. She's like, I specifically told you not to form a cult. And apparently they've forgotten, but Magnus and Ragnar had made a fake cult as a joke. Magnus learns that Mori Shu is at the party, so he needs to go find her. And Xin Yun kind of has like an insight into this cult that Magnus has made and how it has evolved and what it is now. She does tell Magnus like one of their like core principles, one of their main rules, is that they have to accept Downworlder children. And like, if warlock children come to them, they can't turn them away. Which kind of is another one of those insights into Magnus's path. We learn later he had had a really hard childhood where he had been turned away. And then Xin Yun also says that the cult has worshipped both Magnus and Asmodeus. Which is kind of weird to think about because Magnus is like our cool warlock friend. Alec runs into Raphael, who hates parties and people. And he's texting someone named RF, which we can pretty easily imagine is Ragnar Fell, which is so upsetting because at this point Ragnar Fell is believed to be dead, and I would assume that Raphael knows this. So he's texting like his dead best friend, which is very upsetting to me. Alec finds Helen. It's fun to see Helen not with all of her siblings or banished on an island. He finds her making out with a vampire. I was like, oh my gosh, it's Helen. And then later he finds her again with a Shadowhunter. Like they're checking things out or something like that. But the other Shadowhunter's name is Leon. And Helen is very suspicious of Alec, who says he's just at the party to have a good time. And honestly, I can't imagine, even if Alec was at a party having a good time, I feel like he wouldn't look like he wanted to be there
or was enjoying it. And like, I just don't picture Alec lying effectively at all. Alec sees Magnus dancing with his downworlder friends and he thinks it's beautiful. Like it is, like we get this visual of like magic and these beautiful fairies and like all these like amazing traits of the downworlders that make it just like this very like colorful world. And Alec kind of has this moment of like, I'm not a part of that. That's very separate from who he is. But then Alec does join Magnus and they start dancing and it's really cute. And then a battle breaks out because why not keep up the pattern here? It is Barnabas Hale who thinks that Malcolm stole his party. It is Barnabas's mansion in theory and he was gonna call it Barnabash, which I think is really funny. He also says that Malcolm stole his position as the top warlock in Los Angeles. And Barnabas begins to destroy the mansion. Alec goes and saves everyone, and I love seeing Alec in action. We get to see him so much in this book because there's really not a spotlight on him in the other books, and especially not on his fighting skills. The things that we do see about him are those like beautiful moments where he's like caring for other people, and we don't really get to see all of his training go into effect. May I mention that Shinyun has been mysteriously gone this whole time, and then after everybody gets out of this mansion that's like literally collapsing around them, they find Mori Shu, who is dead and appears to have vampire marks on her. So our immediate assumption is that a vampire killed her at some point during the night. Alec gets Raphael's phone number just in case he needs help with Magnus. And it's really cute because Raphael just really hates everyone, but you know, like he kind of appreciates people like being his friend and stuff. Magnus, Alec, and Shinyun go exploring and they find the Red Scrolls of Magic, and it's hilarious because they aren't scrolls. We start to read them and they're just amazing. Only the great poison, he who is handsome and wise and charming and handsome, can lead the faithful to Edom. So cater to the great poison with food and drinks and baths and the occasional massage. It was just fantastic. It's so something Magnus would write as a joke. And throughout the book, like, there's constantly Alec is right next to Magnus, which becomes important later. And, like, we never see Alec, like, not protecting Magnus, which I think was really cute because a lot of the time, like, we see Magnus protecting our crew so much and we don't really see, like, that other side where Alec is, like, protective over Magnus. And it was kind of nice to, like, watch that throughout this story. Magnus insists on traveling via Maserati throughout Rome. And we do kind of go into, like, a deeper side of Magnus where he talks about how he feels like he owes Shinyun something because his accidental cult hurt her and is the reason her parents are dead and she's in this position. And Alec knows that Magnus really wants to make things right and that he's truly kind, even though he acts very nonchalant. And Alec kind of points out like something really important, that Magnus, even though he made it as a joke, made this cult to take in warlock children, not really for anything else and definitely not for like selfish reasons. When we hear Magnus's backstory, I was really upset because we kind of learn what happened to Magnus in his childhood and how his stepfather had like called him a monster and tried to drown him and all this stuff. And that's the first time we see that Magnus like kind of got his magic, or like it came out of him or whatever, that like he realized he had powers of some sort and he like how alone he was during that time. Apparently like the Silent Brothers took him in and taught him to use his magic, which is really interesting because I guess the Silent Brothers are just very different from other Shadow Hunters. And we do see like generally they have kind hearts, like they are, it is like the whole like they're the law kind of thing, but they took him in and taught him, which maybe I think helps Magnus feel like more endeared towards Shadow Hunters. Alec goes to the Institute in Rome and he finds Aline there and she's asking all these questions about his relationship, and Alec is like, this is uncomfortable, like can we stop talking about this? And Aline is really like kind of trying to find out more about Helen. When Alec goes into the Institute, everybody gets super excited, and then everyone is also like, oh, it's not Jace. At this point, we run into Leon and Helen again, and Helen and Aline don't exactly hit it off, but they'll be fine. And then Leon hits on Alec, and when Helen tells him to stop hitting on everyone, I died at Leon's response. The life is short, and I am handsome in French. Magnus goes to the Roman bath, and he's interrupted by Shinyun, who finds him, and Magnus has this kind of like personal metaphor for him and Shinyun, that she's like his dark mirror, like what would have happened to him if the Silent Brothers hadn't taken him in. And they decide to go to the place that the Crimson Hand recently met to like see if they can find anything, and Alec, Helen, and Aline are planning to come meet them. So they find out some new
information, and Alec calls Raphael to say that Morishu was not killed by a vampire, and he describes the actual killing blow. It's kind of clear that the murder weapon was the type of weapon that Shin Yun uses, and Raphael tells Alec not to tell Magnus that he was helpful. So Shin Yun sent Alec, Helen, and Aline into a trap of like fire, and this is kind of when Alec realizes what role Shin Yun is playing in this cult. She is the cursed daughter. And then Shin Yun takes Magnus's power with poison while she was sharing her tragic but true backstory. And then he wakes up in this little prison, and Shin Yun is planning to sacrifice him for her glorious destiny. Shin Yun believes that Asmodeus adopted her because she was adopted by the Crimson Hand, and they were the ones who saved her. She admits that it was really hard to trap Magnus because Alec is always there beside him. Helen admits that she feels like a subpar shadow hunter, and she wanted to take down the Crimson Hand by herself to gain the trust of the shadow hunters and the Clave. Her family and their reputation and the fact that she and Mark are like half fae is all resting on her. And even though we do get to see this younger, more like free version of Helen, it's easy to forget that even at this point, even when she's still so young, she has that type of weight on her. Alec, Helen, and Aline break out. There was like a wall of fire demons, and they run for Magnus. Alec is using his tracking rune, and Magnus is getting back his memories. Barnabas decides to make himself the new leader and sacrifice both Magnus and Shin Yun. Did I like miss something about Barnabas wanting to do this? I was like, that seemed a little out of left field, so I'm assuming I missed something here. And then Alec bursts in, and then Asmodeus is coming. I'm like, this needs to stop. We can't handle a demon of this caliber right now. And Shin Yun still believes that he's going to accept her and let her rule by his side. You are summoning a prince of hell. Do you really think that he's gonna just cozy up to you and be like, yeah, random child who I've never actually met in person, you can rule. And then Asmodeus starts speaking through Barnabas, and then all of a sudden there's like hundreds of pairs of Magnuses and Shin Yuns, and like the reason he's able to pick out which like fighting pair is the real Magnus is when he like hesitates and doesn't like want to hurt someone. And that's like, that's so sweet. Like Magnus is very like kind, but in a like sassy, like I don't need to be kind, sarcastic way. And then like seeing him like question taking the killing blow on a threat, like that shows like a level of compassion that we don't get to see very much. Alec knows him so well that he knows like that's the real Magnus, the one who hesitated. And then Shin Yun gets really jealous because she realizes that Magnus is actually Asmodeus' son. So Asmodeus wants Magnus, not Shin Yun, and he tells Magnus to kill Shin Yun. We do see that Asmodeus had saved Magnus from his stepfather, which is important because that shows that Asmodeus cares about something, even if it is like a selfish thing where maybe he like wanted to save Magnus for something for himself. Like I can't imagine Asmodeus being kind even to his own son. He says that most of his children are not as strong as Magnus, and that they aren't strong enough to live the way Magnus has. Like the length, I think, is like a big thing. Like Magnus has lived a really, really long time, and that's when Shin Yun goes to kill Magnus, and Magnus like drops his knife, and then Alec runs to the pentagram and gives Magnus like his power to break the pentagram. And then Asmodeus turns into a hole in the ground. I feel like there's a lot of like folklore that is behind this, or like some sort of story behind why all this is happening, and I've forgotten or have not read it. They save slash capture Shin Yun. Obviously the Rome Shadow Hunters are gonna come get Shin Yun. She's gonna be executed, so Alec lets her go, which I kind of think is a bad move considering we've got two more books and there's gotta be a villain. Aline and Helen kind of have another little spark. We get to see what that they're going to make it as a couple. Like this is gonna be a thing, and obviously we know it's gonna be a thing, but like if this was a standalone that we were reading for the first time, we would like know that this is going to continue. And then Magnus and Alec like don't want to explain this whole debacle to everyone, so when they go home they get all these different backgrounds and put on different outfits and take pictures like they went all around the world. And then we get like the epilogue where Shin Yun is alive and she has found Ragnar, who is also somehow alive. I get Ragnar and Malcolm mixed up so much. Shin Yun says she has a plan for the eldest curses and says that Ragnar has to help her. So a bit of a cliffhanger. I give it like a 3.5 out of 5 because like usually Cassandra books really hit it out of the park for me, and there was still like not quite that level of like intensity that her series have, but I think it was still important that we got this book to know a lot more about Magnus and like what happened in this in-between time to some of our other characters. What did you think about it? What was your favorite scene? I love Alec and Magnus trying on different clothes. That was fun. I'm gonna try to read the Vane Chronicles. That's the big one I have left until Chain of Gold comes out. My name is Caitlin. Thanks for watching. Bye! A few blessed.